Javier Guzman. Javier is currently the active materials manager for the ExxonMobil Chemical Company. Javier received his PhD degree from UC Davis in 2003 and then spent some time at ITQ with Abilene McCormick as a postdoc. And since then, Javier has held several positions in both academia and industry. And among his many contributions to the hydrocarbon conversion field are catalysts used to produce cleaner fuels, as well as sorbent materials used to separate ethylene and ethane. So it is my pleasure to introduce Javier, and please join me in welcoming him to the podium.
Can you hear me well in the back? Everything okay? All right, good. Well, first of all, let me start by thanking the organizing committee of 926. It's really an honor for me to come here and give this talk. I'm really excited to be here for several reasons. And the first one is because I'll have the opportunity to share with you some of the work that we've been doing in ExxonMobil in the space of conversion of hydrocarbons to chemicals. And it's really a vibrant time right now to be working in this field. And I hope that I will convince you by the end of this talk that we have many great opportunities to work in that using our skills in catalysis. And the second reason is because 20 years ago, I attended my first NAM in Boston, and it was a fantastic experience. So for the students here, I hope that you are having a great week and that you will continue to participate in this society and make many, many contributions in our field. So let me start then by showing you the agenda for the talk today. And I really want to tell you a story that is going to be divided in two parts. I want to start by telling you some of the major trends that we are facing in the chemical industry these days, and how is that's really affecting the way that we approach some of the challenges that we have in technology. So I'm gonna take it from the top down and then identify some opportunities for our work. And then the second part of the talk is really going to be more technical, and I hope to show you some of the work that we've been doing in ExxonMobil in the space of high-performance polyesters. And you will see, as we go through the slides, that we have plenty of opportunities in chemistry, rich catalytic chemistry, and hopefully some of you will help us solve some of these challenges that we have in these particular processes. At the end, we'll have some summary and some time for questions and answers, and then we'll try to wrap it up at that point. All right. So let me start then with the first topic. Let's think about these mega trends that are happening right now in the world and how is it those things are affecting our chemical industry. And to do that, we're going to take a look and mark a point of reference around 2016. And we're going to take a look and how is that things are changing from that point forward for a couple of decades. So we're going to look at 2040 and try to see how are some of these mega trends affecting the way that the whole industry is really changing. I think the first thing to realize is that the population is going to grow from 7 billion people to almost 9 billion people. So we're going to have 1.7, almost 2 billion people more on this planet in only a couple of decades. So that's a major mind-blowing change. And one of the consequences of that is that we're going to require much more energy and much more chemical products. Now the good news is that these people that are going to exist in this planet, they're going to have a much better quality of life because it's expected that the gross, the GDP is going to double in those couple of decades. So people are going to have more resources to access to better quality of life. And that's a great thing because the energy is going to depend, is going to respond to that demand by providing that particular sources and providing around 25% increase in demand in energy. And just to give you an idea on how much that is the existing energy consumption that we have in North America and Latin America combined. So only in a couple of decades, we're gonna have to provide a whole continent of energy. And as a consequence, chemical products that are gonna come from that. Now, every time that you produce something, you're gonna have a consequence.
And the consequence is that we're gonna continue to emit CO2. So the CO2 emissions will continue to rise, and we expect them to be around 10%. Now the good news is that as we seek low carbon energy sources and fuels, and we work harder on energy efficiency processes, we are gonna stabilize the production of CO2, and by the year 2030, we expect that CO2 production is gonna peak. And part of the reason, as I was mentioning, is these low energy fuels, low energy carbon sources for fuels, but also the energy efficiency that we're gonna achieve. And as a technology organization, as this meeting, that we should be proud that a major advantage that is gonna come in the reduction of CO2 is gonna come from the energy efficiency processes that we're gonna have. So for every unit of energy or chemicals that we're gonna be making in a few years, we're gonna be 50% almost more efficient the way that we are right now. And that's a great, great change. Now, how is it these things in particular are affecting the chemical industry? Well, some of the consequences that we're gonna have because of this is that we're gonna have a growth in the middle class. The middle class is really gonna explode. A lot of the population that we are expecting to see, they're gonna go and access to better quality of life. They're gonna have better resources. And a lot of that change is gonna happen in Asia Pacific. You're gonna have countries like China and India that are really gonna increase in population and you're gonna have that. Another consequence that you're gonna see is the urbanization that we are observing in some of those countries. So people will need materials for construction. People will need to power the devices. Have transportation needs. And of course, with all of that, we're gonna respond with some sustainable processes because the society is demanding that. So it's only responsible from our side to start moving in that direction. Now, when you start taking a look at the chemical industry and the energy industry, one thing that is important to realize is that the GDP has been growing and will continue to grow. We just described that it's gonna double twice by 2040, and you can see how the energy sector continues to rise over the years. However, it's rising at a lower pace than the GDP. And when you look at chemicals, it's actually almost double to that of the fuels growth that we are observing. So it's only natural to imagine that some shift is gonna happen in terms of fuels to chemicals. And you are starting to see some of that, and we'll discuss that in a second. Now, I have to say that the scale of things is very different. So when we think about energy and we think about chemicals, those scales are very different. Energy scale is really huge, humongous. And even though we're gonna try to replace and go in that direction to provide some chemical products, there is still gonna be some unbalance and energy demand will continue to be needed in terms of providing that growth that we see. Now, if we think about the chemical company, and in particular ExxonMobil, we make a few products, and those products are, for example, polypropylene, polyethylene, and paraxylene that eventually will become polyester. And you can see that all those three building blocks that we have in the chemical company, they're also growing at a higher rate than GDP. So the demand for all these products is gonna continue for many years to come. And that is really creating an opportunity for different companies and different technology organizations to develop better processes in this direction. And the way, for example, that the chemical companies are reacting to this increased demand in chemicals is by modifying the way that we work. If you think about it, the refinery complexes that we used to have in the 90s, they will only make around 10-15% of yield chemicals. And this is the typical cartoon that you see in many presentations when you see a barrel of oil and only 10-15% of that going to chemicals. But because of these changes that we are observing, and because of this increased demand in chemicals, the refineries and the chemical plants have been becoming more integrated over the years. Not only in the 90s and 2000, they started to integrate sites to maximize some of the chemical productions. And you will see that those numbers will go maybe to 15-25%. But the real change came in the 2010s, when all these chemical shift was happening, and the, for example, realization of natural gas in North America. And you can see how there is a tremendous emphasis now on chemicals at that point. And then everybody started to modify their plants to make more chemicals. And you see now 25-40% of these products going to that particular sector. However, there's so much you can do and modify your existing units. There is a point that you need to invest in new technologies and you need to build new things. And this is exactly what is happening. Now the new integrated processes on crude to chemicals are designed to be a refinery and chemical integration that is actually going to maximize the chemical products. And it's expected that those complexes are going to produce anywhere from 40 to 80% of chemicals. And all of those things have been announced, and you can check the news. And it's interesting to see how companies are racing to build these particular complexes so we can fulfill that demand that we just saw in the earlier slides. Now, if you think about it, for a technology organization, then this poses many, many challenges in terms of how is that we're going to react to these kind of things, and how is that we're going to maximize these chemical productions. And I think this is an area that then opens opportunities for us. If you think about a simplified, very simplified diagram of these integrated chemical processes, you will have your crude coming in, and you will have, for example, a steam cracker, where you're going to make your olefins. And then you need to do all the separation strains that go behind. And this is a very simplified process where you get your olefins and you get your aromatics. When you think about the energy needed to do all that, the two major components of that basically are here. The distillation that you need for the separations in this part, and then the crackers. Because those things run at very high temperatures, you run your crude for milliseconds, and then you obtain your olefins. So this then poses an opportunity for us to work on things that will lower energy and therefore lower CO2 production. So let's think about the crackers. What is happening these days, and what are companies actually doing to try to address this issue? You have seen, for example, now reported that there are options to replace those steam crackers, or at least to modify them with particular furnaces, electrical furnaces. That maybe they're going to use electricity that comes from renewable sources. Maybe you can maximize the heat transfer that you have in these furnaces in a different way. Maybe you can do process intensification for all these reactors in many different ways. So you can lower the temperatures that are required these days for running these processes. The other alternative, which we have heard over the week here, is to develop technologies that they will make on-purpose olefins. Instead of trying to get them from the steam crackers, people are starting to look now again to the conversion of all these alkanes, all the way from propane, methane, ethane, to try to get to the olefins in a direct way. It is suspected that if we can do that, we will be able to do this at lower temperatures and be more efficient in the way that we do. Now, these two, in my mind, have really opened spaces for innovation and opportunities for us in the catalysis field to try to come up with new things. Now, the second thing that really consumes a lot of energy and produces a lot of CO2 comes from the distillations. So we know and we love our reactors, but it's true that the separations is another very expensive part of the process. So when we think about this, what kind of innovations can we do, and what kind of innovations can we bring from our field into these type of aspects? And I want to show you three particular examples here. One is in relationship to adsorption separations. If you think about it, maybe there is a way in which we can replace the distillations that we do conventionally, maybe cryogenic distillations at a very low temperature requiring many, many high energy content to actually run them, and replace that by an adsorbent material that can selectively do your separations. So a few years back, we reported this material, ITQ55, which was the first time that we were able to separate ethane and ethylene basically at room temperature. So that was a very outstanding material that we discovered, and we continue to work on this to try to provide solutions in the separation area. Another way that you can do this is by doing reactive separations. And here is one particular example using some cations that selectively will pull your olefins and continue to drive equilibrium and simplify your separation. Now, another example that we have heard in the week, and I guess many people are working on, is on membranes. Because if you use membranes, then you can, in principle, drive thermodynamics by removing some of the products that you don't want to exist in the reaction network, and then pull equilibrium to make more of your products. All of these, of course, pose their own different challenges. But these are areas for research that are very interesting to continue to work on. Now, the final megatrend that I would like to point your attention is the one related with plastics. We produce around 400 million tons a year of plastics. And almost half of those plastics lose their value in the first cycle that we do, when we do recycle some of these things. And here's a simplified cartoon on what is the typical life cycle processing for plastics. You have your raw materials, and you make your resins, and eventually you go to the consumer. And just to give you an example, only 14% of plastic packaging is collected for recycling. The rest is lost. It goes to landfills, or it gets incinerated for energy. And unfortunately, some of that also ends up as a pollution. So we believe in ExxonMobil that because of the scale that we have and the integration in our sites, that we have an opportunity here to really test, develop, and scale up technologies that will enable something like this, where we will actually take some of those plastics and then regenerate them to another monomer that then we can complete and use several times, and not only use them for a single use, but then keep them in a loop that hopefully maintain them in this particular cycle. And again, this provides a great opportunity for catalysis, because we believe that one of the paths probably here is going to have to do with chemical recycling, chemical deconstruction. So to finish this part, which is just the introduction on the megatrends that are affecting our industry, I would like just to show you this and I think summarize the points that I was trying to make. We believe that this chemical demand is going to outpace the GDP. And therefore, one of the consequences that we are seeing all these crude chemical mega complex being built today to respond to that demand. And that's a great opportunity because those complexes will require new technologies that need to go on board. Another thing that we see, and is real, is this decarbonization that is required. We need to work on processes that will lower energy consumption and therefore reducing CO2 footprint. And finally, we need to start looking again for sustainable solutions. And the way that we've been doing it in one particular example here is on the chemical recycling, but this can be done in many other ways. And we can think about, for example, working on things like these on-purpose olefins as a way to really develop some sustainable solutions. So with that in mind, now I want to move and start talking about the second part of my talk, which is really an example on how we have tried to use our really core expertise in the company to develop a new set of products, a platform for new polyesters. And I want to show you at a high level some of the chemistry that we're doing and really go into the detail of some of the catalytic chemistry. So first of all, I think I want to show you how is that we get the polyesters today. And this is the typical cycle on how we make our PET. What we need to do first is basically take our naphtha, do catalytic reforming, and you get your mixed silanes. Now, as the word says, there's a mixed silanes, and in the polymer sector, you really want pure silanes. You really want only one of these isomers. You want parasilane. You don't want ortho or metasilane. So, companies like us have developed things that are called silane loop, which is nothing more but just isomerization chemistry based on zeolites. And then the next step is an oxidation process to oxidize your parasilane and create your terephthalic acid. And that, of course, is a very simplified way right here that I'm showing. And the final step is another reaction, another catalytic reaction. It's a polymerization with monoethylene glycol or any other diol to end up with your polyester. Now the polyesters can go into many different applications, from the water bottles that we use to fibers in your textiles, and many other applications that are probably less known. What we wanted to do in the company is to find an alternative way to get to polyesters, and not necessarily to this particular one, but maybe something that will have differentiated properties that we can use to formulate different products for the final consumer. And this is what we did. And again, it's a very simplified process. So what we did is, again now, take a look at different monomer, in this case, toluene. And one of the reasons is because then we can take that toluene out of all the fuel pool and then move it into more a chemical production. What we're proposing to do is to do a chemistry where we're going to couple and make this particular molecule, this dimethyl biphenyl, that will get oxidized just the way parasilane was oxidized, and eventually will be polymerized with, again, a diol, getting to a family of polyesters. Now, of course, people working in this field, in the polymer field, they knew about these polyesters probably for the last 30 years. they knew that polyesters like this were great materials for many different applications. But the challenge was to create a monomer to actually complete the process. So ExxonMobil, using our technology, we think that we have something unique here on how to go from toluene to this monomer in an efficient way. And that's the rest of my talk that I'm going to describe here. I'm going to give you examples in each one of these boxes on how is that we were doing some of the chemistry. Now, something that we call hydrocarbon section, something that could be as simple as that first box that I was just showing you, taking the toluene and making the dimethyl biphenyl, in fact contains many, many different kinds of reactions. We have hydroalkylations, we have selective hydrogenations, isomerizations, similar to whatever we know as the silane loop, and transalkylations. So we'll talk a little bit about each one of those. Then the second part, this oxidation section, is not only one reaction. We need to purify some of the products that we make, and we need to do some esterifications and hydrogenation reactions. And you can start seeing now, all of these start building closer and closer to the typical catalysis that we have done and we know how to do with different materials. And then the final step is the polymerization that you do, again, with a diol. And you need to do different things. You can do radical chemistry, or you can do solid state polymerization to finish the product into the final material that you need. Now let's start also realizing that in all of this, there is a separations component, because you need to purify some of the monomers that you need, some of the oxidizing molecules that you're gonna polymerize. But we're not gonna talk about that today. And we're gonna start by talking about the hydrocarbon section. So we're gonna start talking about how is that these things happen, and let's take a look at the particular reactions that we have. So let me start with toluene hydroalkylation. And here's where we get closer to our good old catalysis field, because this is chemistry that we know. And it's chemistry that we love, because we know how to do metal and acid catalysis. And this is a perfect example for that. Imagine that you take your toluene molecule and you need to do your hydrogenation, because you need to partially hydrogenate your molecule through the alkylation. You can do that on a metal side, but you can do it very well and overshoot and then form your methyl cyclohexene, and you don't really want that, because that is going to be very difficult to alkylate your toluene. However, it's not the end of the world. You can dehydrogenate with another metal and come back and then go back in the cycle one more time and give it another shot. Now, the next thing that you need is an acid side, because you're gonna do an alkylation. So then you need an acid side in your olefin combining with your toluene right here to actually do the alkylation. And this is the product that you make, methyl cyclohexyl benzene. This product will be perfect, because it's almost similar as the paraxylene that I was telling you before, that we know how to do and how to process, and we know it makes great products. But nature is not as good, and it gives us a bunch of isomers. So you can imagine that every single methyl group can be positioned in any single carbon in those aromatic rings. Therefore, it's going to create another complication for us. We're going to have to take a zeolite and do isomerization chemistry to get the right monomer that we need for the polyester. Finally, you need to dehydrogenate in another metal to actually create the aromaticity that you need for the polyesters. So you need to dehydrogenate that particular ring to go back to these dimethyl biphenyls. Depending on what isomer you want, that's how you do your isomerization chemistry. Now, the same way that you do one alkylated event, you can do another one, and then you can form dialkylate. And that's not good, because those things are really not molecules that you will need for your polyesters. But those things happen. And I'm showing you here some of the numbers in terms of the typical yields that you will see, that you will expect to see. I'm just going to give you an example on what you actually see when you use different catalysts. And I'm showing particular ones here, palladium catalysts on MCM and WW type materials. And in black is the NCH that you don't want. In yellow right here is your dialkylate. And then everything in between are the different isomers that you need, the different positions of the methyl group that you have. You still have to do isomerizations, but at least you're getting a high conversion to your NCH that you need. Now let me show you how we scan for potential leads. And one of the things that we do is use our high throughput equipment to actually try to understand what is at least the limit of the box that we have to play with. And after we understand leads and try to have some ideas on where we're going to go, then we'll do the fundamental studies to try to understand how is that the chemistry is working. I'm just giving you an example here where we are using one of these high throughput tools that we have to scan a bunch of different zeolites that you can see there and try to correlate performance in terms of the desired products that we're making, the MCHTs, as a function of conversion, as a function of our toluene conversion. And then you can start to see particular trends that are clearly coming up, like the influence of whether you have a 10-member ring zeolite or a 12-member ring zeolite. And this is one particular example, and you can imagine that we have done this for many types of families of materials and found different correlations. The same thing is true for the metal part, because this is, again, a bifunctional catalyst that will require metal and an acid. So we can scan, fix the particular zeolite that you're using, and then scan many different metals. You can scan many different concentrations. You can scan bimetallic compositions. You can do all that. And these high-throughput tools really allow you to test several hypotheses very quickly. So the beauty about these tools is that if you use them right, they really help you test your hypothesis. Now, once you have leads, once you have some understanding on some of the catalysts, on how is that they are actually being different one to another, then you can go and interrogate the catalyst and ask the questions on why is that you are performing in the way that you're performing and how is that you are actually not a good catalyst. So here's just a picture that I'm showing you, some characterization that we did with nanosims, just to demonstrate that the location of these materials once you formulate it is critical, because the aluminum positions, the acid size that you are creating in these things, really correlates with the positions on some of the metals that you put in here. So it's probably difficult to see in the back, but trust me, some of those things correlate in terms of where you find them. And when you do the same type of characterization, but in a catalyst that is really not performing that well, you don't find that type of correlation. The aluminum location doesn't really correlate with your metal location. So that's very well known for many types of chemistries, but now we're finding that it's also true for hydroalkylation chemistry. And that also starts to help us plan how is that we're going to scale up these catalysts. Because one thing is to think about what is the reason that these catalysts are good, but it's also trying to tell you that if you really need to have this proximity of aluminum sites and your metal sites, you need to come up with a synthesis methodology that will allow you to have that as a final product. And there are some things that you can do, like co-extrusion, or some other ways, the pelletized materials, to actually force this particular proximity between the aluminum that you have in there and your metal side. And I'm not showing you all kinds of characterizations and things that we need to demonstrate that this is the case, but we have all that evidence to show this and to demonstrate the proximity effects that we have seen in many other chemistries, and now we see in hydroalkylation. Now, the final thing I will say about hydroalkylation is that we can also test this with theory and try to understand why that is happening. And here I'm showing you cartoons of some calculations that we did, investigating MWW type of materials and positioning the acid site in different locations. One location is inside the pockets, another one is outside using the pore mouth, and the other one is just the acid site on the external surface, where the shape and cavity of the zeolite probably is not going to have an effect. And then we interrogated that by asking, how is that this alkylation will happen? Will it be more favorable in the inside of the particular cups that we have here, or at the mouth? Or it doesn't really matter to have that type of framework, and you can do the chemistry outside. And what we see here in the results, and I'm using a simplified version, instead of putting the methyl groups, we remove the methyl groups, and we're only using benzene as a simplified model reaction for this type of molecules. You can see that the particular case of the pore mouth really stabilizes the transition state. That encapsulation that you see here really stabilizes the transition state because of these wonder battle wall interactions that you have. When you compare that, for example, to the acid side in the external surface area where there is no stabilization by the walls in these cavities, you see that that transition state is really not stabilized and is probably not going to happen. So here is also an indication that you really need these particular zeolites to do this chemistry, that you really need to have shape selectivity to run the chemistry. And talking about shape selectivities, let's now jump to the next problem, which is isomerization. I told you that you can make your dimethyl biphenyls, but the methyl group can go anywhere. So you need to shift that methyl position to the right one. And here's one example where we're taking a particular feed, 2,4, and that's just the position of the methyl groups with respect to each other. And one isomerization thing that you can do is then use zeolites, like the ones that we use for our particular silane isomerizations, and see what happens. So this is the feed, this is the 2,4 dimethyl can see that depending on the zeolite that you use, depending if this is a small pore zeolite or a large pore zeolite, you can control the proton distribution that you're going to get at the end. Now, that's good. That is telling you that there is hope that you can maximize the product that you want. But you also need to come back and realize that some of these chemistries, when they are run industrially, they run at equilibrium. And the problem with that is that in paraxylene case, when you run this at around 200 degrees Celsius, only 20% of paraxylene is recovered every time that you equilibrate this reaction. So we ask the question, do we have the same problem with our dimethyl biphenyls? So we calculate the equilibrium conversions of these things at almost the same temperatures. And you can see that the product here, the 4,4, which is equivalent to that paraxylene, is only 10%. So we are making even less of that particular product. Now, is that a problem? Well, maybe only means that you need to run that loop longer, or maybe you just need to be a little bit bigger, but it's possible. And, but it's important to understand that it's limited by equilibrium. And here's the data to show that we're feeding, in this particular case, 3,3-dimethylbiphenyl, and you can see that if you run this at increasing temperatures, you eventually reach that equilibrium, and these probability distributions right here are those 55, 35, and the particular 10% that in some cases you want is this one right here. So using this isomerization chemistry is a way to obtain a desired isomer. Now, whether you want the 3,4, the 4,4, the 2,3, that's up for depending the product that you're going to make. But there is a handle that we can use with catalysis. Now, there is another thing that we can use. Not only isomerization, we can use another chemistry to access this type of molecules. And what I'm showing you here is the typical isomerization that I just summarized in the last slide. But you can do transalkylation. So you can take another toluene molecule that will insert and replace one of the ones that were in the wrong position. So we can practice that chemistry and see if it's actually happening. Now, one of the disadvantages of transalkylation is that you need to take your aromatic rings and do a partial hybridization so you can fix the position of one of the methyl groups so you can come and do the transalkylation. So in practical life, you will have to hydrogenate again, which means another reactor or maybe another separate, another distillation tower or something. Now, this is the real reaction. This is the simplified reaction, cyclohexyl benzene. What we're doing is using toluene that's going to come and replace the aromatic ring to demonstrate that we're actually, in fact, doing the transalkylation. And we're going to quantify the product of the C13 in that particular exchange. So here's the data that is showing us that, yes, we can do that. And we can do that in different materials. And depending on what you use and what temperatures and conditions you use, you can maximize the conversion. And you can also optimize the particular product that you make. In this case, this C13 that we're trying to make right here in somewhat relatively high conversion. So transalkylation is an alternative technology then to get to the particular monomers that you want, but you have to decide if you need to hydrogenate or not. Now, let me now jump into the oxidation section. We're going to try to be a little bit faster in this as we start moving away from the typical catalysis of these heterogeneous catalysis, and you can see that the final one is definitely the more homogeneous catalysis that we do with the type of complexes that we use for polymerization. So in the oxidation part of the process, this is the typical mid-century process that uses this particular cobalt manganese and bromide catalyst. It's a radical chemistry type of oxidation. But it's very well known that you take your substrate, your particular paraxylene, and then you go and insert your oxygen stepwise. You make your first aldehyde, then you make the acid, then you put the aldehyde on the other side, and then you make the acid on both sides. This is the molecule that you will need then to polymerize. In our particular process, the same thing is true. You take your dimethyl biphenyls, and then you need to form the aldehyde, the acid, then the aldehyde on the other side, and then the acid. And that's exactly what we see when we run these processes. And I'm just showing here paraxylene as a benchmark when you do the oxidation, and two other type of isomers, the 3,4 and the 4,4 dimethyl biphenyl. I'm just showing those to see that in typical and comparative conditions, you will get to that oxidation product, and you will probably be okay in terms of just using these catalysts to get to that oxidation. So there is no real need to develop something new. Now, as with terephthalic acid, the main problem is that you're going to leave an incomplete oxidation product, an aldehyde acid. And that is a problem when you are trying to make plastics, because it's going to bring color. And you need to remove that. So in the same case as the terephthalic acid, these dimethyl biphenyls need some sort of purification. And the way that we do that is by either doing esterification or by doing a hydrogenation. Now, there are some processes, different polymers go through different routes. Either it's the PEM or the standard PET, and that's why it's called purified tertiary acid, and the oxidation product that you have. So what we try to do is to evaluate both of those options to purify these particular diacids in the presence of the aldehyde acid. And what you can see is that one of the challenges that we have is that these diacids and aldehyde acids, they have a very low solubility. So that's going to be a problem, and you need to find conditions that in case, for example, of paraxylene, in case of the tertiary acid, that runs around this point on 10% solubility. To do the same 10% solubility for these dimethyl biphenyls, you're going to have to go higher in temperature. So that's going to be a challenge. But if you find the right place and the right conditions, like now running at this particular temperature, you can convert all the aldehyde acid and only recover your oxidized product, your diacid. So the chemistry, the same chemistry that is used today for tertiary acid, can be used for these new monomers. Now the final thing I want to show you is the polymerization section. And here is the final part when you get to the to actually polyesters. And what I'm going to show you at a very high level is that we use these polyesters in combination with many different monomers. So you can think about combining different, I was telling you about the isomers, different positions. You can combine these with other monomers. And now what you have is an opportunity to access really a platform that can generate amorphous polyesters, crystalline polyesters, or liquid crystal polyesters, depending on the compositions and depending on what monomers you choose to do, depending on what particular diode you use. You can access things now that can be in the fiber sectors, can be commodity thermoplastics, could be high-performance thermoplastics like PE, for example. And I'm going to show you just two quick examples. One is here. One is for transparent applications. So there are all these different polymers, these different polyesters that are used to make this type of transparent applications. And I'm showing you just as a comparative example here, what you normally get in terms of standard PET, this particular high-performance polyester who is in the market, and one of the compositions that we have for one of our polyesters. And you can see that it matches or outperforms all these particular high-performance polyesters in almost every single category that we have here. And the final example I want to show is just on another application for these polyesters. Now, if you move to the right here, you access another type of engineering thermoplastics, polyesters that now can go into tires and some other applications. Again, what we're trying to demonstrate is that with these polyesters and this set of chemistries, you now have a platform to make new materials with a broad range of applications. So finally, I just want to finish showing you these slides and telling you that really it's going to be up to us to respond to these society demands for chemical products that are really made by a cleaner route and more energy efficiency. And I think that's a great challenge. These particular polyesters that I was showing you, they could provide an opportunity for a broad range of applications. We believe that catalysis will continue to play a key role, as you saw in the new technology development. All of the aspects of our standard catalysis were involved from the heterogeneous to homogeneous catalysis. And finally, we really think that this molecular level understanding on the structure property relationship is really essential to commercialize some of these catalytic processes. And in the company, we continue to do that and balance the fundamentals with the applied side. Of course, a work like this cannot be done by a small group of people. We really need an amazing team. And I'm showing some of the ExxonMobil names of different colleagues who have worked in this program for many years, some of our collaborators outside, of course, NAM. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I'll be happy to take any questions. Part of the technology that we're developing in this sense, that we will also use acetic acid.
Now, the challenge will be, like in the existing terephthalic acid, is the solubility and ratios that you use for that. There is the balance on the yield, but also the decomposition that you have on the acetic acid and your product, the oxidized product. So it's a balance on how you use that.
I see this whole thing working in polyesters, but does styrene set a dead end? Could similar kind of intensification be done over on that side, working from things like toluene to stilbene or endene made from various incendiary?
Yeah, and I think this is only one example on one value chain, right, that you go down the path, but styrenes and other things could be other options and other polymers.
I see with the crude cracker, you can make more butadiene and cyclopentadiene than you would normally make with gas crackers. So that makes an intensification possible on the styrenic side.
Yeah, definitely right.
Is it okay from Delft University? I worked for Exxon about 30 years ago and did a lot of the hydro alkylations. Can you comment something on your conformation on the catalyst and the stability of the catalyst?
Yes. For some of the processes like the isomerization and things like that, you have the standard conformation and you have to deal with that. However, it's not to the point that it's very different to the standard technology that we use today, so we have ways to deal with that. Now, when you go to other things like, for example, the hydroalkylation itself, there is a little bit of conformation, but it's really not anything major. And if you think about it, that's the core technology that is at the center of everything. As we were moving from left to right, the technologies were more standard and conventional. The first step to make a monomer was kind of the new thing, the hydroalkylation. But it doesn't really create that much of a code, so it's not really a problem.
Last question.
Javier, could you say a couple words about the technical challenges and what you're talking about, the reuse of plastics? What are the challenges?
Well, I think we understand that mechanical recycling is going to continue to happen, but we need to start looking at chemical recycling. That is probably deconstruction and trying to figure out how to break down the plastics into monomers that then you can use. Now, I think at this point, many different groups are starting to look into this. DOE and the SET, they're starting to have calls for bringing the community together to say, how do we do these kind of things? I think it's going to be up to us to decide if it needs to be done with acids, or it's going to have to be done with thermal cracking, or it's going to have to be done with simple pyrolysis, or what. Well, I think we need to evaluate the diversity of the plastics that we're going to have to convert. So not everything is the same, right? So I think that's the general answer I would like to get.
All right, so let's thank our speaker once again.